Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. We're going to move straight on to the next item of business, which is a statement by Shirley Ann Somerville on Scottish Attainment Challenge, Local Authority Stretch Aims and Recovery and Accelerating Progress in 2022-23. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of our statement. Therefore, there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary for around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to provide this statement to Parliament today to update on the setting of local stretch aims for raising attainment and closing the poverty-related attainment gap. At the outset, I would like to thank all local authorities for approaching this new requirement as part of the Scottish Attainment Challenge with commitment and with rigour. This Government is absolutely committed to closing the poverty-related attainment gap, and since its launch in 2014, the Scottish Attainment Challenge has been a key part of our strategy to do that. We know that it has had a positive impact on children and young people. Our evaluation shows that almost 9 out of 10 headteachers who responded reported improvements in closing the poverty-related attainment gap and or in health and wellbeing as a result of Scottish Attainment Challenge-funded approaches. Building on the progress made to date and in response to the impact of the pandemic which has had on children and young people, particularly those impacted by poverty, I took the opportunity to make some fundamental changes to the Scottish Attainment Challenge. Key amongst these changes is a new mission for the Scottish Attainment Challenge, focusing squarely on outcomes for children and young people, to use education to improve outcomes for children and young people impacted by poverty, with a focus on tackling the poverty-related attainment gap. Now, I don't expect teachers to achieve this on their own. Schools and education services must collaborate across services and with local partners to make progress. And this approach recognises that every local authority has a part to play. So from the £1 billion investment in the Scottish Attainment Challenge over the course of this parliamentary term, we are now distributing strategic equity funding to all 32 authorities, something I know which was welcomed by COSLA. This comes alongside continued investment of over £130 million per year in pupil equity funding, going directly to schools, and continued funding to support the educational outcomes of care-experienced children and young people. Alongside this significant investment, Education Scotland continues to provide local authorities and schools with a range of support. This includes a new approach working with local authorities to agree a model of universal, targeted and intensive support. Additionally, its range of published resources includes the Scotland's new Equity Toolkit, which draws together in one place the range of resources, research and learning through the Scottish Attainment Challenge. Earlier this year, we published the Framework for Recovery and Accelerating Progress, which made clear the respective roles and responsibilities and introduced local stretch aims for closing the poverty-related attainment gap. And it is those local stretch aims that I will focus on now. Now, we know that a ground-up approach works best in embedding improvement, so the stretch aims have been developed by local authorities using local knowledge, data and expertise, and they express each local authority's own ambitions for learning and their learners. Local authorities operate in a range of different contexts and have different starting points for this work, very importantly. And at the same time, however, I am committed to the importance of ensuring that every child and young person has the same opportunities throughout their education, wherever they live in Scotland. Now, we know through the range of analysis of the Scottish Attainment Challenge that we are making progress, but we need to progress more quickly. A key element of the progress made to date has been a change in the culture and ethos across the education system, which has raised the profile of equity in education. Through the refreshed mission of the Scottish Attainment Challenge and the introduction of local stretch aims, we have shifted our focus towards outcomes for our children and young people impacted by poverty. And key to improving those outcomes is the work done in local systems, with schools, third sector organisations and other local services. Further, by introducing a requirement for local stretch aims, we also seek to ensure clear local ownership of progress towards the overall mission of the Scottish Attainment Challenge, to drive a greater transparency around data for improvement, creating opportunities for learning and partnership working, and help address unwarranted variation in attainment and progress in closing the poverty-related attainment gap between local authorities. With both consistency and flexibility in mind, the requirements for stretch aims involve a core plus model. So the core aims are a subset of the existing 11 national improvement framework measures of the poverty-related attainment gap. and they include aims for literacy and numeracy in the broad general education, the senior phase at SEQF levels 5 and 6, the sustained positive destinations through the annual participation measure, and locally identified measures for health and wellbeing. Alongside these core aims, for which all local authorities must set stretch aims, the PLUS element enables local authorities to set aims for their own local improvement priorities. So to be clear, these are locally identified stretch aims determined by councils. They have been undertaken through rigorous local processes to set these stretch aims, and they will work with schools to meet them, keeping in mind very much the local context, the continuing impact of COVID and the increasing impact of the cost of living crisis. Collectively, the core stretch aims set by local authorities show a great deal of ambition for both recovery and accelerating progress. Aggregated, they represent local ambitions for improvement, both on 2020-21, the last year of published data when this requirement was introduced, and 2018-19, the last year for pre-pandemic data. And I welcome that level of ambition. However, I also know that ultimately what matters is the implementation of the plans, supported through strategic equity funding that underpin the stretch aims and the actual progress made locally throughout the academic year. For both overall attainment and in terms of closing the poverty-related attainment gap in literacy and numeracy in primary schools, the collective stretch aims of local authorities amount to working towards achieving the biggest two-year improvement recorded since the introduction of the challenge. If these stretch aims for literacy and numeracy are achieved in full, and this rate of progress continues, we will be on track to substantially eliminate the poverty-related attainment gap in primary schools, which is where the Scottish Attainment Challenge started. Given the effect of COVID-19 on children and young people's achievements of Curriculum for Excellence levels in 2020-21, these aims represent a significant local ambition for recovery back to and beyond the national position pre-pandemic. Now, in terms of the senior phase, we asked local authorities to set stretch aims for SEQF levels 5 and 6. Contrary to the dip in ASL attainment as a result of the pandemic, the changes to approaches in certification played a part in seeing record levels of attainment in the senior phase for 2020-21. Therefore, I very much welcome local authorities' aims to sustain or exceed the levels of attainment seen in 2020-21. In terms of the annual participation measure, which helps us to understand outcomes for young people, local authorities have set aims to improve the already high 92.2% in 2020-21 to 93.4% in 2022-23, and to narrow the poverty-related gap by 1.2 percentage points. In terms of the range of health and wellbeing aims and the PLUS aims, which reflect local authorities' various local priorities, there is a wide range of different aims for progress this year. This includes aims for improved attendance and participation, aims which break down the component parts of some specific core aims, for example, focusing on the specific elements of reading, writing, listening and talking, aims specifically for care-experienced children and young people, and aims that span the full learner journey, with aims for early years and aims that capture the full range of achievements of children and young people in the senior phase, including foundation apprenticeships and a focus on learner pathways. So what matters now is local progress towards these stretch aims. Detailed questions on the ambitions of individual local authorities for their children and young people are, of course, for local authorities themselves to address. And the impact of the pandemic now and the impact of the current cost crisis means the moral imperative to support our children and young people most impacted by poverty to achieve their full potential is stronger than ever. In this difficult context, we remain absolutely focused on our children and young people. And that's why, alongside the £1 billion investment in the Scottish Attainment Challenge, this government is supporting children and young people in numerous ways. We're tackling the cost of the school day through the expansion of free school meals and continued investment in the school clothing grant. Teacher numbers are currently the highest they have been since 2008, and with the number of primary teachers the highest since 1980. We've delivered the highest educational spend and more teachers per pupil than any other UK nation, while also protecting free tuition in higher education. And we're listening to children, young people, parents, carers and professionals through our national discussion and our reform agenda. And we're, of course, delivering on the national mission to tackle child poverty through measures such as our increased Scottish child payment, a key benefit unavailable elsewhere in the UK, which is projected to lift 50,000 children out of poverty next year. Taken together, these demonstrate this government's commitment to making Scotland the best place in the world to grow up. And we will continue to work together with our local government partners to deliver on our shared mission to improve outcomes for children and young people.
Thank you very much indeed. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question could press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call firstly Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of the statement. There's a great deal in the statement that lies behind this statement in terms of the spreadsheets that we've also been sent that deserves much more scrutiny. And I hope that we'll have lots of opportunity for much more scrutiny. But I do welcome some aspects of this statement. I welcome the fact that the Cabinet Secretary acknowledges that it's not just down to teachers to achieve this reduction in the poverty-related attainment gap, that there is much need for further collaborative work between different agencies and services in order to support individuals and their families. I absolutely agree with her that this is about implementation. We've been talking about this for a long time. This is not a new subject. The Audit Scotland have made it clear that they have grave concerns about implementation and outcomes. And she is right also to highlight in the statement the importance of attendance, because when I speak to teachers, the one thing that they say, particularly in the post-pandemic reality, is that they have grave concerns about the regular attendance of pupils at school in general. Now, this statement makes some claims about narrowing the attainment gap, which I think are highly debatable, because I think the facts don't always stack up with what the SNP ministers like to claim in this chamber. But many educational experts have said that to restore Scottish education to the standards it once had, we should be focusing on raising attainment overall. They say that focusing on closing the attainment gap could lead to a levelling down of Scotland's educational attainment overall. And I hope we can all agree that we should be aiming for levelling up. I will come to my question now. Fewer pupils in primary 1, primary 4, primary 7 are achieving the expected levels of literacy, reading, writing, listening, talking and numeracy. So in relation to this statement and the progress that is measurable, what does the Minister now feel is the reason why so little progress, if we can agree there's been progress at all, how little progress has been made so far in this work?
Cabinet Secretary.
There was indeed a lot in that, and to be fair, I would have liked to spend some time on it, because there's actually a fair bit in that I agree with Mr Kerr on, which doesn't always happen in debates, but I welcome what he said in this. And we should certainly strive for more of that, Mr Kerr. I will do my best. He's important, very correctly, to talk about attendance. I would point out that attendance at this moment in time seems to roughly be what it was in pre-pandemic levels, but I do appreciate there is concerns around why pupils aren't attending, and that might be for a variety of reasons. And it is something that both myself, COSLA, ADES have given attention to and will continue to give attention to, because he's quite right to point that out. I think when he looks, and I appreciate there's a lot of information from each of the individual councils on this, when he looks at it, I think he will see that as well as their ambitions to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap, there is information out there about raising attainment overall, because that is a very important point that councils, just as the Scottish Government, are keen to do. So I don't think it's an either-or. I think it's both in all of those. And I hope he finds that in the material as he looks at it. There was, pre-pandemic, year-on-year, a positive trend in the ASIL data. Clearly, that's been impacted by COVID, as Mr Kerr has said, and we will have to await new information to see what the results are as we look to see the approach to the ASIL data in the most recent years. But on the first point I think he made about welcoming further scrutiny to this, I would indeed welcome further scrutiny, and I believe I've written to the committee to invite them to do just that.
Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We hear this statement from the Cabinet Secretary today, with schools closed, kids at home and striking teaching unions outside this Parliament. And the first action the Cabinet Secretary must take is solving this dispute as a matter of the utmost priority. We must not forget that this policy refresh is being paid for by cuts for the poorest children in the poorest communities, described in this Parliament by school leaders as an immoral disgrace. The statement claims that if these stretch aims for literacy and numeracy are achieved in full, and this rate of progress continues, we will be back on track to substantially eliminate the poverty-related attainment gap in primary school. I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to confirm whether that means by 2026. And more cynical people than I, Presiding Officer, would say that this exercise here amounts to an attempt to pass the responsibility to meet the SNP's pledge onto local authorities. No one will forget that this was Nicola Sturgeon's pledge, her defining mission. So, Presiding Officer, this week the SNP are asking teachers to do more. Is it right that next week this government will be asking them to do more with much, much less?
Cabinet Secretary.
I genuinely ask Mr Marra to approach this in the way that the government, Education Scotland and indeed local authorities have, because this was a new process for local authorities, and I would commend them for the way they have approached this. Yes, when I'm talking about substantially eliminate, I mean by 2026. And importantly also, we do recognise the different roles for everyone in this. Yes, there's a role for Scottish Government within this work. Yes, there's a role for our national agencies, from Education Scotland to their attainment advisers, and the work that they do to provide support to local authorities. But there is, of course, an important role for local authorities in that as well. They have a statutory duty, for example, for the provision of education and the improvement for education services. So what we're actually trying to do is not pass the buck here, but genuinely work together to recognise our different roles, to have some transparency around the data, and actually work together to deliver the improvement that we all want to see. He mentions, of course, as well, Presiding Officer, the current pay dispute with teachers. I would, just for the sake of time, briefly reiterate the government's position on this, that the current ask from trade unions for 10% flat rate is not affordable within a fixed budget. And we are absolutely committed to resolving this dispute, but we need to find a way to do that which is fair and affordable within the fixed budget that we have.
Graham Day to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Clearly, this endeavour has to be a partnership one. So can I ask the Scottish Government how the Government and its agencies will support schools and local education authorities to achieve improved attainment and tackle the poverty-related attainment gap? I'm thinking specifically about how they will ensure that the best practice gleaned from all the work done to this point is shared amongst councils and our schools, so that the delivery focus can be on approaches which have been proven to pay dividends.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Mr Day quite rightly points from within that question about the collaborative work that is required to solve the poverty-related attainment gap. So the Framework for Recovery and Accelerating Progress that was published this year makes clear the importance of that collaboration right across the system to share best practice to close that gap. So Education Scotland, for example, does have a key role in this, about the professional advice and guidance, professional learning opportunities, subject networks and through its range of published resources, including that publication highlighting effective practice in the use of pupil equity funding. The launch of Scotland's Equity Toolkit, providing practitioners with an access to a range of evidence and research, is another important piece of work. So again, it points to the collaboration and the way that both national government, national agencies and local government are very much trying to work together to achieve the outcomes that we all want to see for children and young people.
Sue Webber to be followed by Cocab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We can all agree that headteachers play a critical role if we are ever to make progress in closing the attainment gap. Your statement, Cabinet Secretary, claims that 9 out of 10 headteachers have responded citing improvements in closing the poverty-related attainment gap and or health and wellbeing, which perhaps to help us in the Chamber and those watching, the Cabinet Secretary could expand on how this was indeed measured if we are now to focus on outcomes. And again, 9 out of 10 does sound impressive, Cabinet Secretary, but how many actual head teachers responded out of the 2,129 head teachers in Scotland, and how many of our local authorities are represented in this data?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks. I don't have the specific details about the number of headteachers that responded, but it was from the headteacher survey, the most recent headteacher survey that we had. But I would be quite happy to provide that to Ms Webber. It's not a compulsory survey for headteachers to hand back in to government and its agencies, but it was from that survey, and we'll provide further information on that in due course.
Cogab Stewart, to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Can the Cabinet Secretary set out what impact the cost of living crisis and the UK Government wholly inadequate response to it will have on our national mission to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap? And can the Cabinet Secretary set out what action the Scottish Government is taking to support families through the crisis?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Conservatives are asking, is that relevant? Well, yes. And let me be very blunt about why it's relevant. Because while we can do everything within education to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap, the easiest, most simplest way, if only we had the powers to tackle it, would be actually to tackle poverty itself. So that is absolutely why it's relevant. And I am genuinely disappointed, but perhaps not surprised, that the Scottish Conservatives can't see that link. The Scottish Government analysis published in April highlights the devastating impact of successive UK government welfare reforms imposed since 2015. And that has had a very detrimental impact on children and young people right across the country. You contrast that with the Scottish Government approach. In this financial year, of course, we've invested £3 billion through a range of measures which will help mitigate the impacts of the cost of living crisis, whether that's the Scottish Child Payment, the Fuel and Security Fund, or our new winter heating payment, which begins in 2023. So I'm determined through these new stretch aims and the £1 billion increase investment in the Scottish Attainment Challenge programme to support the work that is being done to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap and support those families who need it. But it is disappointing about the lack of action being taken by the UK Government, and that certainly is not helping.
Martin Whitfield, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary said that I don't expect teachers to achieve this on their own. Schools and education services must collaborate across services and local partners to make progress. But with 1,784 fewer teachers since 2007, cuts to support staff over that time, and cuts to staff at the centre, who is it in the schools and education service will do this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, teacher numbers are currently the highest they have been since 2008, with the number of primary teachers the highest since 1980. And indeed, there's now over 2,000 more teachers than before the start of the pandemic. And the ratio of pupil to teachers is at its lowest since 2009. And very much what we've been trying to do through the Scottish Attainment Challenge to recognise the work that, and indeed encourage the work that schools do with other parts of the public sector, and indeed with the third sector colleagues, to work collaboratively on this work. And that is one of the changes that we have taken to widen the approach to the Scottish Attainment Challenge in this refreshed approach that we have.
Evelyn Tweed, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's statement today and that all local authorities have set out their ambitions for tackling the poverty-related attainment gap. Can the Cabinet Secretary give her view on the totality of ambition demonstrated by councils across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I once again would want to take the opportunity to thank councils for the way that they have approached this work. And I'm pleased to see that taken together, the stretch aims for progress point to real ambition for progress, building on the progress that was made particularly pre-pandemic. For literacy and numeracy in primary schools in particular, we are seeing ambitions to close the gap by over 7 percentage points compared to 2021. And if these aims are achieved, they would represent the biggest two-year improvement since the introduction of the challenge. That's very important, very ambitious aims that councils have set, and the Government and Education Scotland look very much forward to supporting them in the work that they're doing, taking close cognizance, of course, of the local context and indeed the further local difficulties that local authorities are experiencing in supporting their children, young people and families during the cost of living crisis.
Willie Rennie, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
This statement is an admission that the poverty-related attainment gap won't be closed completely by 2026. So, at the current rate of progress, can the Education Secretary set out by when, what year, she expects that gap to be closed completely?
Cabinet Secretary.
Forgive me, Presiding Officer, if this wasn't correct. I think I mentioned it during my statement, but for the avoidance of doubt, just in case I didn't, I will repeat it again. If local authorities achieve their stretch aims for literacy and numeracy in full, and this rate of progress is sustained, we'll be on track to substantially eliminate the poverty-related attainment gap in primary schools, which is where the Scottish Attainment Challenge started. And if that wasn't clear enough in my statement, I will add by 2026.
Thank you. Rona Mackay, to be followed by Pam Gosell.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. What steps are being taken to improve outcomes for care experienced pupils, and how are stretch aims being used to drive improvement for care experienced children and young people?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there is, again, a very strong focus within the Scottish Attainment Challenge in assisting care experienced young people as part of our work. There continues to be funding on this specific issue that is given to all local authorities. And I would commend local authorities once again for the way that they are approaching this work, learning from each other with the assistance of Education Scotland, but of course very much learning from each other to ensure that we will see an improvement in attainment for care experienced young people right across the country.
Pam Gosell, to be followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned in her statement that the Scottish Government is tackling the cost of the school day through the expansion of free school meals. We have all heard countless times about the positive impact that eating nutritious meals has on a child's ability to learn. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain why the Scottish Government failed to deliver free school meals for primary 6 and 7 pupils in August? And when will free school meals be extended to the secondary pupils? Does she accept that accelerating the provision of free school meals will have a positive impact on pupils' attainment?
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much agree that free school meals is a very important policy, and that is why the Scottish Government is committed to universal free school meals within primary. That is why the budget for this year included £30 million for capital improvements for local authorities, because there does need to be changes and improvements to facilities to allow us to move forward with primary 6 and 7. That's exactly why we've had to look again at the timeline for this. I would point out, for the benefit of Ms Gosell, that of course the current system within Scotland is the most generous within the UK.
Fulton McGregor, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has set out the responsibility and approach of the Scottish Government and its agencies. However, clearly provision of education in Scotland is the responsibility of local authorities. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me it's crucial that every local authority, including my own in North Lanarkshire, take ownership in the national mission to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would very much point to the fact that don't mind repeating this point, Presiding Officer, that all local authorities have taken the development of stretch aims exceptionally seriously. This is a new approach that we've had, and I would commend them for that. It is crucial, as we've said on a number of occasions now during this statement, about recognising our different responsibilities within different parts of the education system. So there is absolutely a role for the Scottish Government, but there is, as I have mentioned previously, a statutory responsibility for improvement within councils. So it is very important that we work together. Of course, we are supporting the work with the councils with £43 million in strategic equity funding that will assist them in setting the strategic direction for local approaches to closing the poverty-related attainment gap. And the stretch aims that they have set and we are publishing today are underpinning lots of detailed work that a range of local approaches are already being undertaken to improve the situation across our schools and therefore improve outcomes for learners.
And Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The first step to tackle the stubborn attainment gap has to be ensuring that our teachers are properly supported, resourced, and that their health and well-being is properly invested in. So what is the Scottish Government doing to reduce the increasing pressure that is causing so much anxiety in our overstretched teaching profession?
Cabinet Secretary.
One of the ways, and it is just one of the ways, that we would like to do that and we are committed to doing that is a reduction in the class contact time for teachers. That was a commitment that we've made, recognising the heavy workload that teachers have. I completely appreciate and support the fact that national government has a role in supporting our teachers. And for the sake of brevity, I will leave it at that one example, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes this item of business. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item.